going on, everyone? Welcome on into the Sixers Talk. The Philadelphia 76ers on Friday night fall to the Los Angeles Clippers in a late one. This one went all the way down to the wire, 102 to 101. This was flat out frustrating. In a game where your boy was in attendance, I was at the center watching the game live. My first game back at the center for the 2021-22 season. I was excited. I remember talking to my girl on the car ride there, thinking to myself, look, this Clippers team has been struggling this year as in part to do with the fact that they've been missing guys with injury, key guys like Kawhi Leonard and Paul George, and just overall this year, you know, when you got to play in that Western Conference, it's a gauntlet on a night-to-night basis. It's very difficult, but they just came off of a bad loss on Wednesday night, a tough one that went into overtime against the Denver Nuggets. So I definitely thought this was a quality opponent, but the Sixers, you're coming off of a game where Joel Embiid had 50 points. Maybe it was a little naive for me to think that the Sixers would take care of this game, but the fact of the matter is, this game was there for the taking. There were a lot of frustrating things going on in the stretch. A lot of things kind of resurfaced back. Doc Rivers' coaching, we'll get to that in a second as well. But of course, if you're a Sixers fan watching this game tonight, how do you not get the thoughts and those memories back to game 5 of last year against the Hawks? How do you not get those memories of game 7 against the Hawks again last year? And we'll talk about Doc Rivers' press conference, but my. Sixers Nation, I feel like sports fans right now, I feel like we're all in freak out mode yet again for the fifth time in the past year. But this was definitely a rough one, and definitely we'll get to my thoughts, man. But this, I definitely felt as if we could have done better. We certainly could have done better. Before we dive into this game thoroughly, ladies and gentlemen, please, real quick, if you are enjoying this content, make sure you guys hit that like button. And if you are a Philly sports fan, make sure you guys hit the subscribe button. Join on in this family. We talk Philly sports all the damn time, so make sure you guys join on in and subscribe to the channel. And all these recaps and all these content gets rebroadcasted in podcast form. You can find it all under Oi and Philly Sports, and you can find that wherever you stream podcasts. Definitely leave a little rating and subscribe as well. Now, the way this game started, the Clippers did start off hot. They definitely won that first quarter. They had a lot of great runs in there as well, just knocking down some shots. They looked very efficient, and they kind of set the tone bright and early here on this game. We went into the second quarter with a 24-17 deficit to the LA Clippers. And in the second quarter, again, the Clippers taking control in the beginning of it. Around 5:30-ish, the Sixers started going on a run. They got the first lead around 5:30-ish. Sixers were going on a run. Obviously, it was a 7-point deficit in that first quarter, but for the first 7 minutes, they were getting on that run, get the lead at 5:30-ish, and then the Sixers would not look back. They went on a 19-4 run to end the freaking quarter, and then you go into halftime up 14 points. The place was wild. Joel Embiid was hitting everything, threes, low paint shots, mid-range jumpers, you name it. He's dishing out assists. Furkan Korkmaz gets all his points in that second quarter. Some big shots there from him of his total 5 points. We'll get to that too in a little bit. But you're rolling. You have a 14-point lead. JoJo hasn't lost a step from Wednesday night's game against Orlando. And you're thinking to yourself, all right, look, I'm feeling good. You know, I got my Founders IPA, my very, very hip, very hipsterish of me. And I'm hanging out with Scotty Talk Sports and his girl, my girl. And we got Chris Cotta High in there as well. So we're all feeling good. We're having a good time. And then in the second quarter, the third quarter happens, right? the Sixers get themselves a 24-point lead, and we're partying, we're getting ready, we're like, hey, it's Friday night, Sixers gonna win, beat the Clippers, but then we forgot that this is the NBA, and this is Doc Rivers, and this is the Philadelphia 76ers. Nothing is guaranteed here in this basketball league. Well, in the midst of 7 minutes, the LA Clippers were able to turn what was a 24-point deficit into a 10-point deficit heading into the fourth quarter. And then you're like, we're not going to blow this, right? We're not going to blow this. There's no way we're blowing this game, right? But, you know, I was definitely feeling confident, but I honestly cannot tell you guys that I was thoroughly worried about losing this game. However, though, beginning of the fourth quarter, it started off slow, but 2 minutes in, the shots started falling for the LA Clippers. Luke Kennard hits back-to-back threes. Marcus Morris hits another three. And the games at that point, It's now a 4-point lead for the Philadelphia 76ers. They buckle up. They get some shots behind Joel Embiid and Tobias Harris. But the Clippers just were not going away. They finally found their spots in that fourth quarter, and they wound up finding a way to tie this bad boy up 93-93 with, I believe, around a minute and a half left. And in the midst of a minute and a half left, a lot of crap went down. We're down 102-101 after a Joel Embiid layup make. He cuts a deficit. It was a 109-102. It was a 99-102 game. Joel Embiid gets the layup, cuts the lead to one for the Clippers. Marcus Morris on the other side then gets fouled, misses both free throws. Yes. I still can't believe he's from Philly. I digress there. But off the second miss, right, the rebound goes out of bounds. Sixers ball with about 9 seconds left in this game. Now, on the inbound, so this is very, very important circumstance right here. I don't know what the play was drawn up. The play was either to go to Tyrese, if not switch it back to Joel Embiid. But, you know, once you get down, the problem being is that Tyrese Maxey gets the ball near the baseline, essentially. He's running back, gets the ball near the baseline. Great job of press defense by Reggie Jackson on Tyrese Maxey. Tyrese gets the ball near the baseline, and now he has to go cross country to get a freaking get at least create some sort of a play. And there was no opportunity to pass it back to Joel Embiid with 5 seconds. Nicholas Batum, who did a solid job of guarding Joel Embiid with the last 5 minutes of this game, even created a turnover in those last 5 minutes. That was a big one for the LA Clippers. And back to this final play, Tyrese, he has no choice. He's gonna have to take this. He goes for a long. This is like essentially a mid-range floater, and it almost gets stuck on that side of the rim there. And between the rim and the backboard, and that's kind of how this game. Furkey gets a rebound with 0.3 seconds left. There is no way he's going to put that shot back up, and that's how the Philadelphia 76ers fall, literally on the last second shot there. And this is what this truly and honestly was a heartbreaking loss when you think about it. You blew a 24-point lead. I mean, that above all else. I mean, that's kind of the takeaway here. You find yourself down. You get yourself a beautiful run in the end of the second. You get yourself a 24-point lead in the third. In the midst of 7 minutes, that 24-point lead dwindles down to 10. And then in the fourth quarter, slowly, methodically, the LA Clippers did a great job of just staying patient and trusting their own process, essentially. Made some key shots behind Luke Kennard and Marcus Morris. Reggie Jackson and Eric Bledsoe had some tough shots as well. And you saw what happened in the Sixers. Lost this game. Now, look, this was a last possession shot for sure. Came down to that last possession. But listen to what I just said. Listen to the run that the Clippers just went on. Luke Kennard stepping up, who came off the bench here tonight. Marcus Morris, who I believe got the start tonight. And then you had Reggie Jackson, Eric Bledsoe. This was a team effort for the LA Clippers. And look, I've been critical of Tyronn Lue. You know, he actually was rumored before Doc Rivers to be the coach of the Philadelphia 76ers, and I just was not into it. I just did not. I wasn't honestly really sure how it went down with the Cleveland Cavs. I mean, listen, there's a whole stigma when you're the coach of a LeBron-led team, right? You know, you got one of the best players in the world. There's not really much coaching, I feel like. But with the LA Clippers and what he has done is pretty remarkable. I feel like he has shown his coaching prowess. Even last year, taking him all the way to the Western Conference Finals, and you see how those guys are rallying around him, is truly remarkable. And tonight, you know, staying with it, keeping those guys composed, and these guys are a well-coached team. I have to say, these guys were a well-coached team, and eventually those shots fell. With 7 minutes left in the third quarter, those shots started falling. Fourth quarter took some time, but again, those shots started falling. They were starting to make some tough shots, and that's really what happened. Here's the real difference maker as well. One of the real difference makers. Tonight, the whole starting lineup of the LA Clippers scored in double figures. Then you had on your bench, Luke Kennard, like I mentioned, he gets 10 points. Eric Bledsoe actually came off the bench as well, which I just noticed that. He got 8 points. But Isaiah Hartenstein, he got 10 points as well coming off the bench. And then the whole starting lineup of the LA Clippers scored in double figures. You had seven total guys scoring in double figures for the Los Angeles Clippers. You want to know what the Sixers did? Yeah, I'll tell you. Yeah, no worries. I'll tell you. Three guys scored in double figures. Tobias Harris, Tyrese Maxey, and of course, Joel Hans Embiid literally did everything for the Philadelphia 76ers here tonight. This is a problem as well. We'll get to the other stuff, but that right there is a big reason why you lost this game here tonight to the Los Angeles Clippers. This is a LA Clippers team, like I mentioned at the top of this. We're missing some key guys. Paul George, Kawhi Leonard. Those are some big misses here. But the fact that you have to rely night in, night out for Joel Embiid to have a remarkable performance for us to have a chance to win is a problem here tonight. Tobias Harris in that second half, I mean, he missed some key shots. He also made some key shots as well. But when you have that technical late in that fourth quarter, I mean, there's no one around, dude. Just make that free throw. He misses that. That was a key free throw, I will say. That was definitely a key free throw miss there by Tobias Harris. We'll get to the individual performances here, but like, we just have to iterate this. Like, you got to get more from your guys. Oh, you just flat out. I mean, they were a more efficient team on the field tonight overall, but that's because Joel Embiid is literally 60% from the field and 100% from a three-point line with 3-for-3. He is carrying this team, but this is not going to work in the playoffs, right? Like, yeah, we may get to the second round with Joel Embiid just bullying some team, but if that's the case, you got to get a higher seed. So you can bully the likes of a team that doesn't have a center. We'll get to the standings later, and we'll look at the potential matchups at that point. But this is that to me is the big problem. The Clippers were efficient overall throughout the night, but that's because in those final 17 minutes of this game, they really turned the notch up, and they were knocking down threes. They were looking like the Splash Brothers, ladies and gentlemen. And again, and it goes back to the whole perimeter defense problem with this Sixers team. They have struggle defending from the perimeter constantly. That is why I've been so enamored with that Tyrese Halliburton trade, because this team needs some length out on that perimeter. And no, I am not entertaining bringing back Ben Simmons. That's on Ben. That's honestly on Ben. But I digress. Let's look at some of these individual performances. Joel Embiid, like I mentioned, 40 points tonight. Listen, 90 points in two games. 90 points in two games. That's crazy. That's absolutely crazy. That's not Will Chamberlain's 100 points in one game, but 90 points in two games. Absolutely remarkable by Joel Embiid. And I feel for this man. This man leaves it out on the court night in, night out. He did it as well. And, you know, I mentioned that turnover against Nicholas Batum. Listen, I can't fault, like, most people would say, Joel Embiid, why aren't you abusing Nicholas Batum in those minutes? Look, he's fucking tired. You play 36 minutes, and you carry a basketball team. Let me see how you feel. Like, seriously. There's more things I want to get to, but I think the fan base, like, we just allow our emotions get to us too much. That's why I'm recording this on a Saturday morning, because last night, you know, I wanted to hang out. I wanted to enjoy them. I don't usually get to go out to the Wells Fargo Center. I had a great time, so I wanted to relax. Woke up early this morning to get my notes together, get my thoughts together, and record this video here. But we just think way too much on our emotions, man. And the whole, like, Joel Embiid, he needs to be down in the paint more. Like, dude, he was perfect from the three-point line here tonight. Like, I there's really not much I'm going to fault Joel Embiid here for tonight when this man's literally carrying a whole fucking franchise on his goddamn back. All right, Tobias Harris tonight, 20 points here. Yeah, it was 47% from the field, not bad. But like I said, some key shots that he had to make. I thought defensively, this was one of his better performances. I thought, especially like on those one-on-one defensive moments, I thought he really did a really good job. A couple opportunities guarding Reggie Jackson. I thought he was great on the switches, those pick and rolls as well, carrying over and defending that guy who's on that role. And I thought, to me, Tobias, you know, it was a great contribution from him. I want him to make some more big shots, especially in that fourth quarter. But I will say, overall, I can't really kill Tobias Harris here tonight. T- Tyrese Maxey, another solid performance with 19 points. The youngster, again, stepping up and being some sort of a contributor for this team. That last shot, that was a tough shot for anyone. And that's, and we'll get to Doc Rivers in a second, but that play was just not what I would have called. Or at least, like, what was that? Was that really the play? Like, for you with 9 seconds left to inbounds a ball essentially near the baseline, that to me is not what you should have called, right? If that was in fact what was the play on that was drawn up by the coaching staff at that timeout. But oh, hey now, what's up, ring light? All right, so the rest of the starting lineup, Furkan Korkmaz had 5 points, and like I said, all of that was in the second quarter. Those 5 points were in the second quarter. It was a big part of that run the Sixers had that grabbed them the lead, that 19-2 run. But other than that, really did not do much of anything else. He was 2-7 from the field, 1-6 from the three-point line. So my man was cold, and he had 5 points tonight in 39 minutes. He's got to do more. Flat out, you're playing 39 minutes. You have to do more. I did not see that aggressive, energetic Furkan Korkmaz that we have seen before. Now, I will mention this. In the second quarter, I did see him limping a little bit. I don't know exactly what that was. I did not get that injury report. But other than that, if you are that hurt, honestly, sit out. I mean, you're more of a detriment, to be honest with you. As we all know, Furkey's not the best defender either. But 39 minutes, 5 points. I mean, you're healthy enough to play 39 minutes, and that's my point, man. 5 points is just not flat out not going to cut it. Isaiah Joe got the start here tonight. I had high expectations for Isaiah Joe this year, but this is a kid that was a second-round pick, so we all do need to remember that. And he's getting an opportunity, and tonight he really did not take full advantage of that opportunity. Are we really going to kill a second-round draft pick here? But that's kind of the point of the lack of role players around Joel Embiid. And injuries are a issue as well, which we'll get to in a second. George Niang, 30 minutes, 7 points. Oh, man, he was 27.3 from the field and 14.3 from the three-point line. He's got to step it up. Charlie Brown Jr. has been a fantastic story this year. The North Philly boy has found a way to get another contract here with the Sixers, and he's providing some length and some perimeter defense. He's energetic, and you love his defensive prowess. I mean, he's not Matisse Thybulle, but he provides some energy on that side of the ball. But man, oh man, his offensive game so cringeworthy. Man can even make a single layup. He's got this jump shot where if anyone's seen Michael Kidd-Gilchrist's jump shot, that's essentially what it is. Like this little side ball, like heave. It's really weird. It's honestly really weird, but. Andre Drummond, 5 points here tonight in 11 minutes. He had 11 boards at least. At least he got himself 11 boards. That's usually his name of his game, man. Because offensively, sometimes it just don't happen for Andre. But obviously, look, the lack of role players is really killing us right now. And you know, we didn't have Danny Green. We did not have Why am I blanking here? Danny Green, we didn't have Matisse Thybulle. We still are out with Shake Milton as well. Seth Curry was on the injury report. They decided to sit him out. So you literally, right there, Danny, Tease, Shake, and Seth, those are all key players. Those are all key wing players. And you're out with all of those guys. And that's kind of a problem as well. That's why you have to kind of rely on guys like Isaiah Joe to give you some production. You got to rely on guys like George Niang and Charlie Brown to kind of give you some production out on the perimeter and on those wings as well. And that is kind of a recipe for disaster, if I'm being quite honest with you guys. And there's not much that you can do with that. Honestly, there's really not much that you can do with that. And that's kind of the reason why you got 7 key players for the Clippers. I was almost going to say the Lakers. Who scored in double figures, and the Sixers only had 3 guys scoring in double figures. And against a team like the Clippers who are well coached, and look, this is the NBA. There are a lot of good teams. Don't get it twisted. And the Clippers are still pretty damn good, even without the likes of Paul George and Kawhi Leonard. And I do think we need to remember that. And they are really well coached. And that's kind of the issue. Now let's get to the dying topic. It's a perfect segue. Let's get to the coaching. A lot of heat was taken by Doc Rivers tonight, and as he should. You lost the game, a game where you had a 24-point lead, that was slowly dwindled down. There was some bad decision making go in that stretch as well. And it's not like he didn't take his timeouts. He did take those timeouts. But you blew a lead. There's just, it's just the fact of the matter. You blew the lead, and especially there's this stigma around Doc Rivers, and as there should be, we all know the Game 7 mantra with Doc. What's it, like 15 Game 7s he's blown now in his career? That's a real thing, Doc. And now, I mean, and again, we go back to the whole mantra of the Sixers fan, the mentality of the Sixers fan right now. We just went through Game 5 last year. We just went through Game 7 last year against the Hawks. And now this year, you see this. And I'm sure a lot of Sixers fans had a serious PTSD as that final buzzer went off and we lost this game. Now, look, the issue being at hand, to me, it's tough for me to be super critical of Doc's coaching when, in fact, that you just didn't have guys step up. At some point, and Shaq always says this, players got to play. Coaches can coach all they want, but if players don't play, it really does not matter. But one thing I will criticize Doc on, the press conferences has been really something of a critique. So when I do not know who the reporter was in the presser, asked Doc Rivers about was coaching a factor in blowing this loss, and Doc responds, would you ask Greg Popovich that question? Yes, sir. Si, senor. I would definitely ask Greg Popovich that question, because if Greg Popovich's team blew a 24-point lead the way you did, he's got to answer to that. You know why? Because he's the head coach of the San Antonio Spurs. You are the head coach of the Philadelphia 76ers. You have to answer to that. I'm 100% sympathetic. I'm very compassionate. I understand my fellow human beings, and I understand that he's probably frustrated with that. What else can you possibly do when you are forced to start a guy like Isaiah Joe out there? And you got Furkan Korkmaz in 39 minutes putting up 5 points. Now, a lot of people want to criticize him for not bringing in Joel Embiid earlier in the game. What do you guys want him to do? Do you guys want to run Joel Embiid into the ground for a meaningless regular season game? Now, if this was the playoffs and he does that, I'd be right there with you ready to kill Doc Rivers. But this is the regular season. And y'all kind of forget that Joel Embiid has an injury history. So Doc has to be more aware of the situation. Just listen, you took the loss. Just take the question. I personally, I don't think that coaching was the big reason why we lost this game. Although I do think that Tyronn Lue outcoached him. But what else are we supposed to do when players can't play? I just think that that's just really tough to kind of come at Doc with. And it goes back to, and it all stems back to Daryl Morey and the whole Mike Missanelli interview. If you guys listen to it, it was definitely a great listen. It's about a 25-minute listen on the podcast streams. I thoroughly enjoyed it. It was very, very informative, but it doesn't seem like there's much change going to happen with this team. I mean, the market is what it is. Ben Simmons' value is very, very tricky. This is a kid with just potential. It's literally the same exact situation as the Carson Wentz deal. You know, when you're trying to trade Carson Wentz, you're essentially trading potential because he literally just came off of his worst year statistically. And with Ben Simmons, you're essentially just trading potential because we all saw how he just pretty much crumbled in a 7-game series against the Atlanta Hawks last year. You're essentially selling potential. You're selling the defensive mastermind that he is, the size, the athleticism, the creativity on the shot creations for others, not for himself. you gotta specify that. And that's kind of what you're trading away. And unfortunately, is that Ben is kind of being paid like a top three player on this team. And we're kind of expecting that return back, but when you see what just happened over the past year with Ben Simmons, it's kind of hard to get that kind of return back. And so for Daryl, I do think he's playing it smartly. I do think you kind of have to be patient with this. It is going to take some time, but this team definitely needs some help. And yes, we will get Seth Curry back. We will get Shake Milton back. By the way, the Shake injury is concerning to me. This has been almost 2 weeks now. He's missed basketball. And it doesn't seem like he's getting any better. And that's a back injury. Back injuries are no joke, guys. No joke. Matisse will be back in another week. And Danny Green will be back for the playoffs. I know Danny Green. And it's so funny. Last night, so I was at the game. They gave out posters to fans that were coming in. They gave away Danny Green. Obviously, they're you know, marketing the whole city edition Spectrum jerseys, which, by the way, love the whole concept. I think the concept has been knocking out the park, much better than last year's Boathouse Row concept. Using the black for Boathouse Row, come on, Ben. Come on, Sixers. But this concept here has been absolutely spectacular. I love it. The Sixers give away the Spectrum City Edition concept posters. And, of course, they have Danny Green as a poster. There was more than one fan that wanted to throw it out because they're kind of sick and tired of Danny Green. And, honestly, I don't think it's Danny Green's play and lack of missing time as well. I think it's his comments off the court coming at fans, which it's honestly kind of funny to watch. For someone in the middle kind of understanding where Danny Green's coming from and then also understanding where the fans are coming from as well. But to give away free posters of Danny Green, yeah, man, that's tough sell for Sixers to Sixers fans, man. Very tough sell. You really couldn't give us a Joel Embiid or even I guess Tobias Harris wouldn't work either, but I would have much rather Tobias Harris. But, hey, I'll still take a Danny Green poster. I'll still hang it up in my man cave along with my Carlos Valderrama, my Uni 2021-2022 group picture, and my Charles Barkley poster as well. So it's definitely will be an addition to the man cave for sure. But oh boy, it's definitely a low point in Sixers Nation right now. I mean, Wednesday was a nice little moment with Joel Embiid getting that 50-point game, and tonight or Friday night, I should say, it was the complete opposite, the absolute complete opposite, man. I'm there with you guys. I completely understand the frustrations. It is one game though. I will say it was one game, and we're just gonna have to learn from this. It's a tough loss, but this is what happens. Like the Sixers, and this is something you guys should be picking up on. When the Sixers play against teams who have more than three shooters, right, and the Clippers have more than three shooters, they struggle. And it's part and due with the fact that, number one, you have a tough time with perimeter defense, and number two, you have a tough time with knocking down your own shots in general, right? So this you saw this against the Hornets. We saw this against the Wizards. We're seeing this here again on Friday night against the Clippers, a team that can space out the court and pretty damn well. The Sixers just have to find ways to knock down shots. And, I mean, I would like to say they should go out and get some guys that can help them with that. But realistically, that's just something that just cannot – it probably just cannot happen. All right, so next up for the Sixers, they'll be back in action tomorrow night on Sunday, 7 p.m. Obviously, bird season's over, so we got a lot of we're going to have a lot of weekend – or Sunday games as well for the Flyers, I'm assuming, as well, too. But tomorrow they will be in San Antonio, if I'm not mistaken. They will be in San Antonio for their one and only trip down there. We'll see how that matchup goes. Use this as a learning experience and take it to San Antonio. Put up those shots. I want to see them put up those shots tomorrow night against San Antonio. And do not let just kill San Antonio. Just please kill. And in all seriousness, please kill San Antonio early, because I want to give Joel Embiid some rest. I'm sure he's going to play. I want Joel Embiid to get some rest. 90 points in two nights. Give that man some rest. And he can't, because we need him. We need him on nights. And then it's funny, because I was thinking this earlier on in the morning. To an extent, this kind of reminds me of the Russell Westbrook MVP season. Russ literally carried that Oklahoma City team. And if it wasn't for Russell Westbrook carrying that team, they would have literally been maybe a lottery, like close to a lottery team. You know what I'm saying? And if without Joel Embiid, this Sixers team would be a lottery team, in all honesty. And it's crazy how he's carrying the Sixers. Let's look at the standings real quick. So right now, with that loss, it drops us back down to sixth place. They're battling with the Cleveland. The Cavs are trying to stay in that top five of the Eastern Conferences. I cannot wait to face those guys. I want to see what and firsthand, I've seen a little bit of highlights. It's crazy to see what they're doing right now with three bigs. Three bigs that can kind of shoot, essentially. So that should be an interesting matchup. But right now, they are in sixth place currently. The Hornets literally right on their tail with the same amount of wins. And then you got the Hornets, the Raptors, and the Wizards and the Celtics rounding out the Eastern Conference. But that's why, like I say, like these for the Sixers, like let's try to get at least. I think the Sixers can realistically get to that fourth seed, and that's really where we want to try to get. And then at that point, you can face off against the right now the Cavs are the fifth seed, the Bucks are the fourth seed right now. I think the higher the seed, the better, for sure. Definitely for sure. All right, guys, that's going to do it here today for this Sixers recap. Again, the Sixers fall to the LA Clippers in a heartbreaking one, 102-101. I did vlog. It was my first vlog for the 2022 year. We were at the center. So this weekend, I will have that vlog up there for you guys to check out the time that down there at the Wells Fargo. So it was great. It was an absolutely great experience. I would much rather the win as well, but definitely a lot of fun, and stay tuned for that one. It's going to be a good one. It's definitely going to be a good one. Ladies and gentlemen, make sure you guys hit the like button if you guys enjoyed the content. That would really mean the world to me. And, of course, if you guys are a Philly sports fan, join on this family. Make sure you guys are subscribed for some more Philly sports content. Don't join. Come on. Come on. What are you waiting for? Hit that subscribe button. Join on in. And, of course, make sure you guys subscribe to Oi and Philly Sports. We rebroadcast all of these into podcast form. So make sure you guys rate and subscribe for some more on there as well. Until next time, ladies and gentlemen, I go by name Ed Parcero Philly. And I'm telling you guys, let's go Sixers. Talk to you guys soon.